Good morning. Hello. Welcome to Bridgeport Chapel. It's awesome to have everybody here today. Whether you come here every week or if you're from out of town or Hawaii or wherever, welcome. Glad to be here with you. We get together because we love each other. We get together to encourage each other, to have fun. But most importantly, we get together because we have a God that has called us together, that has given us a common purpose and a common salvation through Christ. And we come to celebrate that with each other. So before we start here, be sure and check the announcer to see what kind of things we have coming up. Right after the service today, there will be a potluck, and you're all welcome to that. And then a baby shower for my brother Matthew and his wife Sarah and their new little baby that's forthcoming. So that'll be after the potluck, and you're invited to that as well. And so with that, let's pray and begin here. Father, we do thank you for your love for us and that you've intervened in our lives, that you were not content to just be by yourself, but that you created us, and then that you weren't content to leave us in our sin, but that you came and walked among us, and you died and rose again for us. We love you, and we bless you for that. We want to pray today for the people in our congregation, especially that are sick, that are undergoing treatment. I think of Arnie, and pray for their healing, and that you would give them peace and encouragement as they walk through sickness, and be with those that are healing as well from surgery and from sickness, and please give them strength as they heal, and even if it takes longer than they expected, help them to be comforted and to be a comfort to others in that as well. Thank you that you will give us new bodies and that we have the everlasting hope of living with you. And so we love you, God, and thank you for letting us be here today. In Jesus' name. All right, let's sing together. Let's stand up and turn in your hymn book to page 630. What a friend we have.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Still our refuge. Take sacrifice for a safety. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In His arms He'll take and shield thee. Thou will find a solace there. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away as wounds which mar the chosen love bring many sons to upon a cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. So I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His words have paid my rent.
And if that is true, that Christ loved us that much, there's really only one response to that.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. I am found. I am yours. I am loved. I'm made pure. I have life. I can breathe. I am healed. I am free. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. You are strong. You are sure. You are life. You endure. And you are good. Always true. You are light. Breaking through. You are more than enough. You are here. You are love. And you are hope. And you are grace. You're all I have. You're everything. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my heart. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my life. So here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true.
Amen. May it be so. You may be seated. Arnie, would you come and help us review our memory verse?
We're privileged to have God's word, and I'm just excited every day to think about it and speak it. Today we have an easy verse. We're just reviewing Matthew 4:19. So can you do that with me? And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Matthew 4:19. Well done.
All right, we'll have the ushers come forward to receive the morning offering.
Word of prayer.
Lord, we are here because we love you in our hearts. And you love us so much that you come down, be with us every day, and light up our lives in ways that we don't even understand, but we're here because you do that for us. Thank you so much for being with us, and now let us just be humble in offering back to you a little bit of the many, many blessings that you offer unto us, that your gifts, your graces, may grow and grow and grow, not only in our hearts, but in the hearts around us and the world around us too. Let the love and the power of Jesus Christ just grow and grow and grow because of what we do with our little bit here today. Amen.
Thank you, Jane. Scripture says we look forward to a new heavens and a new earth where righteousness dwells. But right now we're going to read about the creation of the earth that we have for now. So let's turn together to Genesis chapter 2. We'll be reading verses 15 through 25 and we'll stand together if you're able. If you're using one of the pew Bibles, it is page number 2. Genesis chapter 2, starting at verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This is at last bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. You stand together still. We'll sing a couple more songs. This song, every time I'm singing it, I don't know why, but I always think, it says, "All my life you have been faithful," and I always think to myself, "So far," and that's a pretty good indicator of what the future will be like. If God has been faithful so far, he probably will be in the future, because thankfully he doesn't change.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I'm able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your Lord. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
Your goodness.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am.
My life.
All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Let's turn to page 128 in your hymnal. We sing the goodness of God, and we sing the power of God. Goodness without power isn't much help. Power without goodness is tyranny. But God is complete.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad, and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with fruit. He formed the creatures with his word, and then pronounced them. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread, or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below that makes thy glory.
You may be seated as Jonathan comes to share the word with us.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to be together. Welcome to those of you out-of-towners. It's good to have you together with us, too. As you know, I keep saying it, we're flying over the Old Testament. I'm not quite sure I'm going to make it by the end of the year, but we'll get to the end of the Old Testament at some point. We looked last week at the writing called Ecclesiastes. It's the journaling or the musings of a teacher. He calls himself Kohelet. It's the name in Hebrew. And that's what the name of the book is actually in Hebrew, the teacher. Solomon, he comes to us from a humanistic perspective in that book of Ecclesiastes. We talked about that, and from that vantage point, he says that life is, what did he say it is? Vanity or futility, absurdity, meaningless. That seems to be that underlying theme there in the book of Ecclesiastes. Everything under the sun is futility. He shares with us that he's seen it all, right? He's tried it all. He had the opportunity, unlike probably any of us, to do that. His experiences, however, didn't offer him meaning in life. What is the meaning of life? He's kind of pessimistic as he shares, and yet God is brought into the equation throughout the book. Along the way, and he praises wisdom, he praises pleasure and enjoyment in life, but he says these don't satisfy, these don't bring full meaning. In other words, he sees something missing from a human perspective. Something is wrong. There's no control over our destiny. Death seems to be the inevitable end for everything and everybody. But he doesn't stop there, does he? I think the structure and the approach of that the book, and it's a difficult book, but I think the way he's writing, at least in part, is a teaching method. So his point is kind of veiled throughout the writing, but the interested reader will find God, will be led to God, and will find meaning. And as you know, most likely, some of you have it memorized, in the end, chapter 12, he makes a brief conclusive statement. Basically, he says, without God at the center, without the fear of the Lord in our lives, then life is meaningless. It's absurd. It's almost laughable. But with God, with the fear of God, with faith in him, with him at the center, the teacher has deduced that there's meaning to life. There's fullness. There's fulfillment. There's hope. So the Christian, that's most of us, we do well to remember that, don't we? To contemplate, to humbly study this book. And as we remember that for ourselves, we remember the need around us in the world that if you don't have Christ, it's pretty meaningless. There's not much ahead of you. And maybe everything looks good in your unbelieving neighbor's life. It looks like there's pleasure and fulfillment and he's doing fine, but they're missing meaning without Jesus. Now, one of the realms that the teacher Solomon pursued in his human desire for meaning, coming off Ecclesiastes, for meaning and fulfillment, he pursued love. He pursued women. I think he discovered that that didn't work. That was one of the many things that didn't work. Vanity, vanity. So Solomon, the teacher, wrote some more. He wrote a song. It's a love song. It's a love story. It's a love story to impart wisdom. We need to remember that as we come to the next book. Solomon's a prolific writer. And we have less than one-third of his written Proverbs, or less than that. We know he wrote songs and poems. Some would dispute this. But we're crediting Solomon for the Song of Songs. That's why sometimes we call it the Song of Solomon. It's this fifth book of the five books of wisdom that we've been going through, right? We looked at Job a while back. Psalms, Solomon wrote a psalm or two. Proverbs, Solomon wrote most of Proverbs. Ecclesiastes, Solomon the author. And then the fifth book here is the Song of Songs. Now, apparently only one of Solomon's 1,005 songs survived, and we have it. It was a good one. He turned out to be a one-hit wonder, I guess, but it even made it into the Word of God. I mean, that's pretty good. The title then, the Song of Songs, which is the original title, or just the song, it probably lets us know that it was a song above all songs. It was a good one. It was important. Now, we keep in mind, as we come to this next book, the Song of Solomon, in our flyover. As always, Solomon's writing from a Jewish perspective. He's writing in a Jewish Israeli context. So, of course, he's using terminology of the day, right? It's a love story with the terminology of the day. We will notice that the story takes place in two areas, northern Israel, as well as farther south in the city of Jerusalem, which was where Solomon was from. His palace was there, of course. He also has vineyards and goats and sheep and comparisons to gold and ivory and certain oils that we may not recognize and a bunch of other things like this. So, all to say, the book is oriented to its physical, its geographical, cultural setting. And we will always get deeper understanding from this book or others as we study out those cultural and geographical, historical parts, particulars. We won't do a lot of that this morning, but we're moving quickly. But we do want to remember that there is more meaning found as we look at those things deeper in personal study or small group or such things as that. So this story is... Well, what is it? Exactly. J. Vernon McGee said this was the most neglected book in the Bible. I thought about neglecting it this morning, just, you know, jump into the next one, but no, I'm not sure if that's true anymore, but it's certainly enigmatic. That is, it's mysterious. There's some puzzlement around this song, and it has been, I think, misunderstood. Over the years, we should point out, before we get into it, that there's been different interpretations of what has been said. In fact, that continues to today. Some of you may end up disagreeing with me. That's great. You can disagree with me in the interpretation that we take. In history, the prevailing interpretation of this song sees it as an allegory. That is basically taking the wording to mean something other than the literal expression in the book. Now, part of the reason for taking the Song of Songs as an allegory was that Greek influence on the church in history. And that influence downplayed the value and the sacredness of the physical body. And that led to a loss of value in the realms of human love and sexuality. Now, many Christians, for whatever reason, have felt compelled to see the story, this poetry, the plain language as allegorical, meaning something else, usually referring to God's love for the church or for Israel in particular in the past. And then along the same lines, you might see it as typological, a type that is a forerunner of God's love for his bride, the church. Naturally, Solomon would have no concept of what the church is at the point of his writing. Others see it as a collection of sort of romantic poetry from the era. More along the lines of how I would see it as something like a drama, a poetic drama principally played out between two people, the man and the woman, probably Solomon and his girl that eventually becomes his bride, his wife, partway through the book, the drama. Now, there may be some hypothetical elements here as we think about the story, but I think it's best to interpret, to take the writing of Song of Songs at face value. Literally a love story, a journal, albeit a graphic one at points, concerning the dating relationship, the wedding, and the early part of the married life for this couple, for these two lovers. Now, we can't be sure, and some questions arise, but was this Solomon's first wife? While he was young, while he was still on track with the Lord, before he decided to pursue 999 more? Well, whatever the case is, and there's questions that surround that, undoubtedly, that we should work through. But I think whatever the case is, Solomon knew God's ideal. Remember, he had great wisdom. He didn't always live it out, though, did he? Solomon knew God's intention for marriage and for sexuality. So this, we need to remember, is a book of wisdom. It's Solomon imparting advice and guidance. What we see in the book of Song of Songs is God's ideal for romantic love. Solomon knew that, whether or not he lived it out. Now, I want you to keep in mind that this is not just for the married people in the room. I'm not asking you to leave if you're not married. This is for all of us in certain ways. Someone made this comment. I read this. They said, the Song of Songs is about Christ and the church. Don't make the Bible about man. This is not about Solomon. That makes me uncomfortable. Well, I get it, right? I mean, it does make us feel some discomfort as we go through. But I think we need to use proper interpretation, and we need to see it as best we can as it's written. And as we do that, there might be some discomfort involved. But hey, we need to orient our viewpoint sometimes to God. We're in the flesh. We need constant help. I know I do. Maybe some of you have got it all figured out, but we need constant help turning toward truth, particularly in the culture we find ourselves in. Now, as valuable as it is to try to find and identify the human authorship and the timing and such of a book, we remember, of course, that this book was authored by the Holy Spirit. He stands behind all of Scripture, God himself. Isn't it interesting then that the Song of Songs, this love story, was inspired in the same way that, say, the words of Jesus were in the New Testament? I think God here is celebrating and actually promoting his gift of physical love between man and woman, husband and wife, proper romantic love, proper sexuality expressed in our, this case, poetic and story form. As Christians, we're committed, aren't we, to the principles of Scripture? Letting good theology that we derive from the principles of Scripture direct our lives. Well, I don't need to tell you, but our culture is feeding us lies about human sexuality, about marriage, about love, even about gender. Our world's attempting to redefine all of that. So let the Song of Solomon teach and guide us. God wrote this book intentionally and inspired it as truth for us. So turn there, if you're not already there, kind of in the middle of your Bible, right after Ecclesiastes, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and then Song of Solomon. You can turn to chapter 1. I want to share with you an outline. I try to do this. I think it helps us as we look at the different books. It's a basic outline, but I found this to be very helpful, especially in this particular book. So you can see it there. There's three parts, and they're logical parts. You have the engagement period, or the preparation for marriage. If you're married, we all had some sort of period like that. That's the first section. The second one is the wedding, or the wedding night even, and that's the fulfillment within marriage is the second one. The third one then, which actually takes up the last half of the book, is marriage and some discussion and some we'll look at it a little bit, commitment, the realities of marriage in some ways. So look at the first chapter, and we're going to fly over this. The girl speaks in verse 2. Now, this girl is a country bumpkin. I don't know about that girl, but the one in the writing, she's a country bumpkin, but she has noticed Solomon. She's met him, but I don't think she knows who he is. She doesn't know he's king, but she's deeply attracted to him as a person. It seems that she wants him, however, to initiate relationship. Now, you look at verses 2, 3, and 4. She's deeply attracted, but she doesn't run after this man. And you should notice there in verse 3, part of her attraction is, I think, her desire for him is more than skin deep. She says his name, and when she says his name, she means who he is, his character. In the latter part of verse 4, this enters most likely another voice, if you're thinking about it as a drama, which isn't always necessarily correct, but this third part enters in. It's called the young women of Jerusalem, or the friends of the beloved. It's an outside perspective from these friends. It shows up a couple times throughout the book. And they are rejoicing with the potential of this love, these women or whoever it is. I know that's probably just a Jerusalem and Israeli thing. None of you guys have ever like gossiped or rejoiced about your romantic attractions. But anyway, this girl, she is a Shulamite. That's from the northern part of Israel. And she is sometimes referred to as the beloved in this story. In verse 5, she describes herself, and it's almost a self-conscious description that she says here. She says she is black, she is dark of skin. Now, she may have been naturally dark-skinned, but that's not what she's self-conscious about. Look at verse 6. She was feeling shame about her tan. Now, how many of you felt shame about your tan? I mean, we're almost exactly the opposite. Man, where'd you get that tan? I want to get one like you. But in her case, untanned skin was more desired in that culture. And it was a sign that she was of low status, probably maybe even in poverty. She had to be out physically working in the sun. And isn't it interesting? We still struggle and think self-consciously concerning our appearance, don't we? Maybe there's a lesson there. Even if the standard changes culture to culture, that's something we have to work on. In verse 7, we're moving through chapter 1 here, that she thinks this man, now sometimes, by the way, the man, we assume him to be Solomon, is also called the lover, the lover and the beloved. She thinks this man is a shepherd, and she wonders where he pastures his sheep. You can see that in verse 7. Now, some would see this shepherd as a third player, another voice. I would say that perhaps this is Solomon. He did a little shepherding on the side. We know he loved nature and animals. He was David's son, by the way. And it was in his blood. But there's a good chance that he was maybe in disguise, or he was taking the day off from being king. And he originally met this girl and struck up a conversation or whatever it was. And she wonders what's going on here. Now, it's a common pitfall in relationships, isn't it? Romantic relationships, to move too quickly, to run after things too quickly. Now, this girl's desire is obvious, but I think she's acting with restraint. You know, it's a whole lot easier to get into a relationship than it is to live in relationship. And in verse 9, moving forward, the lover, Solomon, praises his darling's beauty and her jewelry. He compares her to a horse. Now, I don't know if you compare your wife to a horse, but there, again, there's that cultural reasons for the horse comparison. Solomon was also a lover of horses. So by now, he has pursued her, and they're going steady, you might say. They're enjoying this courting period, the first period of our, first segment of our book, the dating relationship, whatever you want to call it. This is back and forth, chapter 1, 12, 13, and 14. The woman is, some of your Bibles, I think, delineate that. They'll have lover or woman or man, you know, as the different conversations take place. That's added, that's not inspired. Some of your Bibles may not have that. But in verses 12 through 14, the woman is praising her lover for his attractive characteristics. She's comparing them to perfume and attractive smells. Now, in this segment, I think we want to be careful with our interpretation. I don't think she's describing their physical relationship. There's a picture of what she felt about him. He was like good-smelling stuff. He stood out among other men like flowers in a desert. Now, those in that culture, if they could afford it, they wore perfumes to cover all those earthy, vineyardy animals, manure, sweat smells that they were accumulating during the day's work. And that attractive smell of probably expensive perfume was like her man. Verse 15, the man, he responds, again, we're switching back and forth, the lover responds in kind by praising her beauty. And probably when he says she has eyes like a dove, that's another cultural setting, you got to look at that, but there was a rabbinic teaching that said that a bride with beautiful eyes possesses beautiful character. Maybe that's what the lover is after when he says something about her eyes like a dove. This is not the only time he says that. Now it's back and forth sweet talk, 16 and 17. The woman delights in him. She remembers probably the setting where they met first, outdoors. She's using metaphorical language. She's picturing the pastures and the trees and the forests. So their desire for each other is pretty apparent, isn't it? There's affirmation of each other's character. There's physical attraction and desire. There's sexual desire. But notice verse 7. This is chapter 2, verse 7. The woman speaking here, and in deep desire for her man, she is actually practicing restraint. She is teaching restraint in these words. She turns, as it were, to the young women of Jerusalem, and she says, "I charge you, do not stir up or awaken love until the appropriate time." So in this first section, pre-marriage, there are lots of expressions that seem like they're concerning sexual desire. Now, I think we can view these as God-given, legitimate desires, right? But as someone has said, if they are God-given, they need to be God-guided. The Bible has a lot to say with guidance. by way of guidance for this subject. These two want to be physically affectionate with one another. They have a legitimate desire for romance, and they don't hide it, but sexual restraint is practiced by the lovers. They are properly channeling that desire. They're deferring pleasure until the proper time. Solomon, the lover, latter part of chapter 2, he's now pursuing her. He's calling her. He wants to know her. And the woman says in verse 15, look at 15 just quickly. She says, they should catch the foxes. In other words, they should not let issues or others come between the two of them. Let the vineyard grow. Lots of metaphorical language. Let the relationship develop. Now, maybe they had some disagreements or some annoyances that popped up, and that's why she says that. The relationship has developed, and that takes us into chapter 3, toward the end of their dating period, their engagement period, and the girl repeats in verse 5 of chapter 3 the same thing she said in the last chapter, do not stir up or awaken love until the appropriate time. Be patient. The right timing, the right person are important. Now look at chapter 3, verse 6. It's the long-awaited wedding day. So this brings us to that second section of the book. We've moved from the engagement period to the wedding. And then at verse 6, what is that I see coming? In other words, check it out. It's Solomon's traveling couch and all its splendor. Now she takes, or the narrator, I think, here, takes and describes and elaborates on this, the Solomon's entourage, for the good part of the rest of the chapter. And Solomon, he's sending this entourage to fetch her for the wedding. Remember, she's up north, and he wants her down in Jerusalem at the palace for the wedding. And there's a lot of dangerous paths in between. So he offers protection. There, you can see the description there. There's military protection and whatnot. And I don't know, but that's an important part of a man's role in the relationship is protection. And we can maybe glean a little bit there. I think this passage is probably interjected from a narrator's point of view. You might say that's a little uncommon in this drama. Most of it is with the main characters. As you look at chapter 4, verse 1, all the way through 5, verse 1, is a somewhat plain description of the wedding night. That takes a whole chapter. They're alone, and Solomon, the man, the husband, now describes his wife's beauty. By the way, he calls her his bride 5 times in this section, and so we know this is post-marriage. Verse 7, look at verse 7 of chapter 4. He sums up for a moment as he speaks to his bride. He says, you are absolutely beautiful, my darling. There is no imperfection in you. We already know that she perceived imperfection in herself, right? I think the lover here chooses her to be his perfect woman. I mean, what is perfection after all? So much of it is in the eye. It's in the choice of the beholder. Solomon is choosing her. He takes his time and he sweet talks her with gentleness and tenderness nearly through the rest of that chapter. This is the proper time. They have waited to enjoy each other physically until this moment. Verse 12 of chapter 4 describes her as a virgin. Now, maybe it makes you squirm a little bit to read this stuff, but I think we should remember that this is pure, this is right, this is God created. Look at the last phrase of verse 1 of chapter 5. So chapter 5, verse 1, is a pretty long verse. Look at the last sentence there. Some would say that the speaker here is God himself. But the encouragement here is for married lovers to drink and imbibe deeply. Marriage is the time and the place, without shame, to accept, to enjoy, to celebrate that gift of sexuality. Now the rest of chapter 5, it begins to describe real marriage. Remember, we're now into section 3 of the book, which, like I said before, covers the latter half of the book. So that starts at verse 2 of chapter 5. Through the end of this story, it's the early marriage for this couple, and you see in chapter 5 and chapter 6 that some conflict arises in the relationship. There's maybe some indifference and emotional separation, it seems. You can look at that and determine for yourself, but this is real marriage, isn't it? It's a little bit inevitable for this to happen. But it also describes resolution, all in poetry and song. I don't know how many of you describe conflict and resolution in poetry, but Solomon does. And notice that throughout their conflict, there's a desire, there's a continuing attraction toward one another. This, of course, is based on a commitment. It's based on a choice. It's not based on a feeling. It's not based on emotion. Particularly, you begin to see the sappy language come back toward the end of chapter 6. As they work through their conflict, they come back together. And how do you resolve conflict in marriage? I guess nobody really knows. But what is the goal? Is the goal to win? Is the goal to prove yourself? Maybe the goal should be to win the friendship and not the argument. Not to hold out on each other, but to win the friendship back. You may not see eye to eye, but you can walk hand in hand. It's interesting that 25% of the book is devoted to conflict and resolution, essentially. Chapter 7 portrays some maturing in the couple's marriage. Perhaps a few years have passed. Some of this is dealing with connecting rightly with each other emotionally. Some of what you see in chapter 7 is a maturing of their physical relationship. That's the nature of the book. As they keep the marriage bed pure, that's a phrase that's used in the book of Hebrews, they grow in pleasing one another and enjoying their sexuality. It's something that they grow in over the years. I'll leave the details of that for you husbands and wives to study later. But look at chapter 8. Look at verses 6 and 7. There's some culminating statements here made by the woman concerning their love. Just ponder this with me for a minute. True love in this context that we're talking about romance, attraction, desire for your spouse. She says true love in this realm is passionate. It's irresistible. It's strong. It's exclusive. You can look at her description there. She pictures it in similes in order to dramatize it. And in verse 7, this love she is talking about is priceless. It cannot be purchased. No one's wealth is great enough to exchange what is properly done maritally in love. Do you see what she's talking about? But the culture will tell us the exact opposite, actually. Our culture, probably theirs in a way too. The culture will attempt to sell us the latest and the greatest sexually perverted invention of the devil. And hey, our flesh will agree. Without the Spirit, we will see that as fulfilling, as cool. It will be promoted to be far more fulfilling and pleasure-giving than anything you have in a stuffy, old, traditional, God-designed marriage. But my friends, according to the Word of God, the culture's wrong. Our flesh is wrong. There's nothing you can exchange it for. It's priceless. No amount of money can buy the beauty, the fulfillment of God-created physical love in marriage. God's behind it, after all. It's His design. One man, one woman, as fashioned by God, committed for life in marriage. It's going to be good. God makes good things. The devil doesn't create anything. What does he do? He takes God's good design and out of spite, out of hate, he perverts God's good creation. In this case, the beauty of good sex in marriage alone. It's Satan's design to destroy. I think this song is pertinent for us in that it's a reminder that God has given an incredible gift to us, this love and fulfillment within marriage, done His way. If we think we're missing out on pleasure and fulfillment, we're wrong. Now, we find ourselves in a lot of different places in life. How do we get this sort of fulfillment? Much of that we already know, don't we? We saw a lot of that here in the passage. Do not awaken love before its proper time. And I do want to emphasize that this message speaks to us all. The married people, the single who may marry one day, the single who may never marry or remarry. Those are all fine places to be, all good places. I think the book teaches each of us the right view of romantic love and sexuality. Wherever you find yourself, let's remember these things. We want to abide by God's design in our context. And we also, I think the friends in the book teach us to rejoice and support others in their context. Some of us have a past in not doing sexuality God's way. There's some foolishness. There's some bad choices. Maybe that's still going on. But a word to that. Start today. Pick up today. Believe God. Believe the message of this book. Do whatever it takes to get started down that path today. God is merciful. God is forgiving. Many of you promote doing it God's way by your example. And I'm grateful for many of you. It doesn't mean perfection, probably for any of us, but many of you have made choices, commitments. You've left the past behind. Keep pursuing God's good way. So a couple of reminders along this line. In order to find fulfillment, romance, enjoy sexuality properly, we want to do it God's way, right? It's like riding horseback. How many of you like to ride horseback? Oh, there's more of you than that, but now I've actually rarely ridden horseback, but it can be a challenge, depending on who you are and who the animal, what the animal is, to actually get on the horse, to get seated on the thing securely. Maybe you get partway on, and the horse decides to walk over there and eat some grass, and you fall off before you're seated. Maybe you want to get on there securely, so you launch yourself on with great vigor, but it was a little too much vigor, and you fall off the other side. I don't know, Scott can tell us if he's seen all that, but when it comes to this subject here in the book of Song of Songs, I think we can fall off the horse on both sides. So based upon the text, a couple of quick reminders. We can fall off the horse on the left side. I think we can pervert God's good design for sexuality by avoiding it, by not engaging, by minimizing. Now, of course, I'm talking about doing it the right way, the right timing, patience, and all of that. That's all part of the equation, but we can pervert God's good design by not enjoying God's good gift in the proper place in our context, physical love and sex in marriage alone. Now, admittedly, sometimes this is a struggle, perhaps because of the way we were raised or because of abuse in our past. But if you are married, I think God would have us pursue it, enjoy it, as it's an important part of your marriage relationship. You know, the Bible often offers negative advice toward morality. In other words, don't do this, don't do that, avoid this. But I think the main message of Song of Solomon is positive. Embrace it in its proper place. It's God's gift at the proper time. There's no shame as we follow God's design. In fact, there are blessings when we do. Well, we can fall off the horse on the right side too, can't we? Getting behind on my slides here. We can fall off on the right side, and this is where many of those warnings of Scripture come in, and praise God we have them. As we know, the culture, the devil, our own flesh offers millions of alternatives to God's way. There are all sorts of options we can engage in to mess ourselves up physically, or relationally, I should say, sexually. Pornography is a leading industry in our world. It's destroying, and there are real and lasting consequences. Remember, God designed romance and sex. We're not missing out on anything by doing it His way. It's like fire, you know? I was thinking about Rainy Jones and his fire pit outside. Feels good, doesn't it, on a crisp evening? It provides light and warmth and ambiance. There's nothing like it. But since it feels good like that, I'm going to take it inside and put it on the couch so I can have the warmth and the ambiance and everything in there. That's not going to work, is it? It's destructive when it's not in its proper place. It's the same for romance, for sex. So don't fall off the horse, either to the left by being ashamed of God's good design, or to the right by giving ourselves to wrong avenues of sexuality. We continue to work on being firmly planted in the saddle of God's design for you, wherever you are in your context, in your situation, as you take the message of the Song of Solomon, the Song of Songs, and apply it to your life. Andrew and the team, would you guys come up? And I want to mention the elders. A couple elders should be available for prayer if you have a prayer need afterwards. And, you know, along these lines, don't be afraid to ask for help. It's hard to open your mouth sometimes, but a trusted friend is very valuable. Or ask the elders for help, for prayer. Pursue God's way in your context. Take the next step. Let's pray together. God, thank you for this special book that we have in our Bibles on purpose. It may not be easy to think about the content here, and I pray that it would impact us properly, and that it would be helpful for each of our lives, each of our situations, wherever we find ourselves, that we can take your challenge, that we can recognize that you are serious about this subject and that you created it for the right place and the right time with great delight for good. God, let it impact our lives, please, today. Thank you for being here amongst us and for being authoritative in your word. I pray your blessing as we go from this place, that we could move beyond today and that we could indeed make changes in our lives that would glorify you, bring us into the place we were designed to be as your creatures. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I don't want to say this just because I'm distantly related to the preacher, but that may have been one of the best sermons on Song of Solomon I've ever heard. Maybe the only one. All right, let's close with a song together. 793 in your hymn book. I think we'll sing all five verses. It just praises God. We'll praise God together for His creation in a variety of aspects, how the world He's given us. Let's stand together. 793.
For the beauty of the earth, for the glory of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies, Lord of all, to Thee we raise this our for the wonder. lifteth holy hands above, offering up on every shore her pure sacrifice of love. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. And for thyself, best gift divine, to our race so freely give. For that great, great love of thine, peace on earth and joy in heaven. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our
And I want to reiterate one more time, you're all invited and welcome to the potluck and the shower following. Let's pray together. Father, we love you and we cannot repay you for your goodness to us. We are forever grateful. Show us more of yourself through your word, through our friends, through your creation. Help us to always respond correctly to you and to give our lives wholly to you. Be with us the rest of this day. Thank you for the meal following. Please bless those that have prepared it, and we thank you for it, and just guide us on our way. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.